before you, you know, were to sit down and learn how to plant an apple tree, you would probably want to know what an apple looks like, right? So it makes a lot of sense for us to take a look first at what we mean by batches. What is the point of a batch, or the concept of using batches in manufacturing? So let me show you a classic example we've shown for years. Imagine that you've got your production cycle spliced or sliced into campaigns. Those campaigns were further divided into individual batches of end products. So for example, we've got chicken nuggets here, and here is a specific batch of chicken nuggets number 124. Now within that, what we're calling a pie batch, you will also divide that further into what we call unit batches. The unit batches are the different procedures that you do to produce this batch of product. So in this case, churning, breading, etc. And then you can divide that further into sub-batches, and those things can overlap. So let's just pretend that that's how your manufacturing environment works. You have these repeated events. This is batch 123. We basically repeat that to get 124 and then 125. So there are a series of repeated events. And then within those events, there are other events that repeat over and over again. You know, each batch has its churning unit batch, its breading unit batch, etc. Well, wouldn't it be great if you could compare one of these repeated events to another? To be able to compare apples to apples exactly what's going on among these different batches, so that you can spot the batch that's having problems, or maybe the batch that is the golden batch, the very best batch you ever made, and you'd like to be able to document what that was and how to repeat it. So in order to do that type of comparison, we use a client application called the Batch View add-in to ProcessBook, and also an add-in to Excel to do this inside a spreadsheet. Now in ProcessBook, what we're talking about is looking at these individual batches or unit batches, and in this case here, each one of these that you're looking at, that would be an individual unit batch, and comparing them one to another. Now these would all have occurred at different times. So if you were to drill down through this, if you can just barely see the dates there, each of the timestamps for the start and end of each of these batches are different, because each one of these bars in the Gantt chart represents a different batch. And likewise, each one of these trends here is a process value during one of those batches. So for example, this is the pressure and this is the temperature during a typical batch. So we've overlaid them all to make comparisons better. Now compare that to what you can do in a spreadsheet, where I think it's even more obvious what we're going after here. What we're going after is having a kind of a one-stop shopping for all the information you might want to find out to help compare one batch to another. So in this spreadsheet, I've got a nice little engine going here where I simply type in the name of a unit, for example. A unit would be typically a place in which you actually do the manufacturing, a physical unit. So you type in a unit, and then you see immediately all the different unit batches that were processed in that unit. And in this case, we're using a wildcard character, which means we get all the units that begin with the letters R-4. Now, each one of these is a batch record, and each one of these has a start time, an end time, an optional product ID, a batch ID. And there are some other attributes as well that we'll get into later on. But the question always comes up, okay, now that I have this batch record, and please remember, the batch record, that batch record stops right about here. So we're not seeing it. Everything over on this side of this spreadsheet are part of the batch records. What you're seeing over here are the mappings that we've made by matching this right here, this alias name, and this right here, the unit name. By doing a simple match between that alias and the unit, we can find the corresponding tag name. So for example, when we look at this particular unit and we compare it to this alias here, level, we come up with this tag name. As you can see, it's different than the other tag name. So these records right here, these are records that are, well, excuse me, let me point this out. These tag names right here, they're not part of the batch database. However, making use of the aliases that are associated with these batch units, we can associate a specific PI tag with a specific unit. That's how we make the connection to the real-time data. So what do you do once you have that tag name, once you have these list of tags that go with each one of these units here? Well, you can do really anything you want. The simple example we have here is we've taken the start and end of this particular batch record. We've used that along with the tag name to produce what the average of that temperature was between, you know, this start time and this end time right here. So each one of these records is going to show us, I mean, each one of these batch records is going to give us a different answer, of course. That's a specific batch, this DFR99. During that particular batch, this tag name had that average. So that's the useful, you know, part of going out and finding these batch records. Once you've found them and once you can map them to a list of tag names, then you can start producing some statistics. And of course, it's by producing those statistics that you can make those apples to apples comparisons, you know, looking for the outliers. So, if this is the goal, how do we get to that goal? Well, let's take a look at the exercise. In this exercise, our objective is that we're going to build or configure the PIBatch generator interface. We know this as PIBagen, and we refer to it as PIBagen. We're going to configure that interface so that it automatically tracks events and sub-events related to some unit in the field. And it's going to store that in the PIBatch records on the PI server so that later in a subsequent exercise, we'll be able to use the PIBatch view add-ins to ProcessBook and Excel to go out and find those batches that we just saw. And you'll notice as we do this exercise, some of the things we're going to have to track in these batch records are batch ID. Well, every batch record has to have a batch ID. But we're going to be tracking product name, the recipe, and of course start and end times, and every batch has those two as well. We're also going to be linking process data to this through the alias mechanism, and we'll explain more about that later. We'll be looking at concentration, level, and temperature. Now, the mechanism we're going to use to do all this is through some simple configuration. There is an application, and we'll be looking at this in more detail later, but there's an application called the PIBatch generator. Now, this configuration screen that you see right here, this PIBatch generator configuration screen, let me bring it over here. Now, this allows you to specify certain things that are required in order to generate these batch records. So configuration is going to be required, and the configuration is spelled out in the exercise. The requirements for this exercise are spelled out. For example, one of the configuration points is something called the active point, or the configuration items is something called the active point, and also the active point behavior. Now, both of these are spelled out here. The active point is going to be this tag here, and the behavior is going to be pulse. So let's take a look at what this particular configuration parameter is. The active point is really the linchpin for all of the batch activity. An active point is simply this. It's a tag whose behavior triggers the start and end of batches in the batch record database that we're creating. In other words, it's the activity of this active point that determines for us when a batch starts and when it ends. Now, here's an illustration that explains what this active point is doing. Imagine that this is a PI tag whose value goes up in increments. This is kind of an ideal situation. It's going exactly one integer up at the beginning and end of each batch. If you have a tag like that, that increments in even intervals, or increments at discrete intervals, every time a batch starts, it may be something like a batch ID number that you get from the batch execution system. If you have something like that, the changing of this value signals the trigger of a new batch and the end of the previous batch, then you could set up what we call a step behavior. Step behavior means simply it's kind of like a stair step. Each time this changes, that starts one batch, and then when it changes again, that ends the previous batch and starts the next batch. So each time we go through here, that's going to start one batch and end the previous batch. Now compare that to the pulse behavior. With the pulse active point behavior, when the value changes from a zero state to a non-zero state, that triggers the start of the batch. the end of the batch doesn't occur until that active point goes back to a zero state. So we have two different mechanisms for the actual triggering of the batch. And maybe it's belaboring the obvious, but remember, each time you start a batch, that's going to create a new batch record. So this is now going to be the start time of that new batch record. The end is going to be the end time. Now, the other attributes we were looking at are all, well, they're fairly straightforward. They are PI tags that will be used to determine things like the batch ID and the product and the procedure that's associated with that batch record. And all we do is we simply interrogate the value. We determine the value of this tag at the time that the active point triggers, at the start time of the batch. So whatever this value is, then that's the value we're going to take it's going to take in the batch record for this, you know, unit name, the product name, the procedure name, etc. Now we have some bells and whistles beyond that. We'll get into all that as we go through and take a look at the configuration. So that's our exercise. And what you just saw was the approach. And you notice there's a little stop sign to warn you, please see if you can do it first just using the approach. But if you can't do it just by the approach, there is a step-by-step solution you'll find in the lab.